Thank you. with a welcoming speech by Uncle Govindan, none other than our Johor State Coordinator. Please, Uncle.
Thank you, MC. Om Sai Ram. Humble pranam, sir. Swami salute his feet. Dear brothers and sisters, welcome, welcome, welcome. First of all, let's welcome our guest of honor, Brother Professor Anil Kumar Kamaraju, and his wife, Sister Vijaya. I think I didn't hear you. I would also like to welcome Brother Mahindran, our Deputy President of Sai Council, who is accompanying Brother Anil, Professor Anil, and his tour. I must thank our Sai Council of Malaysia for arranging Professor Anil Kumar's visit to Malaysia, and not forgetting Brother Dr. Ravi, a senior member of JD Sai Center and Zone 4 coordinator, for also being instrumental in arranging Professor Anil Kumar's trip. On behalf of the organizing committee, I would also like to thank all of you for coming for this talk, despite being a working day and heavy rain. Some of you have come from very far. It only goes to show your enthusiasm in attending the talk. Let's give a big round of applause for yourself. I'm sure the talk by Professor Anil Kumar today on Sai mission and its continuity will equip us with enhanced knowledge on Bhagavan and his mission, and clear the doubts we carry with us after Swami attained his Samadhi. I'm sure a number of you would want to ask questions. You have already collected the slip of paper when you were entering the hall. Now, write clearly the questions that you want to ask and put it into the box right down here. The first row of seats is on the left, one box is on the left, and the other box is on the right. Now, with those welcoming remarks, I would end. Thank you.
Thank you, Uncle, for that very warm address. Now, I would like to call upon onto stage Brother Dr. Ravindran, our Zone 4 coordinator, to introduce our guest speaker, Professor Anil Kumar.
With pranams at the lotus feet of Bhagawan Sri Siddha Sai Baba, I thank all of you for coming for today's important function. We have here amidst us a person who has been Swami's right hand, I would say, and he has been with Swami for many years. To introduce, I think it's my pleasant task to introduce who he is. Many of you know him as, you don't know exactly what his profession is. Let me just tell you in brief. If I won't tell you the whole thing because it's going to take time. We are all waiting anxiously for Brother Anil to address us. Well, he got his post graduation and master MSc in biosciences from the Andhra University, Visakhapatnam, Andhra Pradesh. is the principal of science, three synthesized to higher learning, Vrindavan campus, 1989-1995. Was a professor of biosciences, Sri Sathya of Higher Learning, Prashanthi Nilayam, 1995 to date. So he's still the professor of biosciences in Prashanthi Nilayam. Well, over his past, he has been a zonal convener of the Sri Sathya organizations of Andhra, 1918 and 1984. He has taken a lot of efforts to go around the world enlightening people about Swami and his mission. There's been the US, UK, Canada, Singapore, Malaysia, the name goes on, the places go on. But most important of all is an interpreter for Swami's discourses since 1989. So many of you would have heard him on stage, how Swami sometimes will even correct him. But the important thing to understand is he's such a bubbly person that I know him. He also speaks in Radio Sai for Global Harmony. He has accompanied Swami in various locations, Kodaikanal, Ooty, Delhi, Bombay, Madras, Bangalore. Happily married to Vijayalakshmi, with children settled, and also he's a pen pal like me. What are the challenges facing us after Baba left his mortal coil? It's a question many of you have in your hearts. How will the mission continue? What improvements can be made to attract more people to come? Why is there a lackadaisical attitude of some devotees? There must be reasons. Swami, the embodiment of love, we want to see changes at all levels of our devotees. I must at the same time now thank Brother Govindan, the state chairman, for organizing the whole event with his assistant, Brother Krishnan, and not forgetting Brother Mahindra, my right hand. Why I say that's because he's a bit scared, you see. Well, anyway, he has got Dr. Vijay to get his appeasement for. But what I have seen in Mahindran is a man full of energy, and the entire Far East tour of the countries in Zone 4 was initially a plan by Brother Mahindran, and both of us met up with Brother Anil, and today we see the fusion. He just finished Langkawi, he has come to Penang, then to Kuala Lumpur yesterday, and today he's here with us. Tomorrow he drives off to Singapore for 2 days, and then he flies with Mahindran all the way to Brunei. I wish that we could hear a bit more of Brother Anil, but I'm sure all of you are wishing or rather waiting for him to speak to all of you. With these few words, I'd like to thank all of you for your presence, because without you, there is no organization. The organization is yours, and you have a role to play. You have a mission to perform, because Swami is guiding you from within. Jai Sai Ram.
Thank you, Uncle. Without further ado, after the very good introduction, I now take great pleasure to call upon Professor Anil Kumar to address us on the topic Sai Mission and its continuity.
With pranam, salute and sweet of our most beloved Bhagavan, members of the council, the chairman of the zone, brothers and sisters of Sai family of Juhubaru. This is my second visit to this place. The earlier one took place in the year 2005. But, hello? Can you hear me? But the attraction to Jaguar continues on and on. I thank you for your warm welcome, nice reception, good things said about me. This visit has a difference from the past visit. Earlier, when Bhagwan was available physically, we could have certain things discussed, deliberated, and reflected upon. But today, we are meeting at a time when Bhagwan is not physically available. The scenario is different. Situation is different. The topics are so framed as to meet the present situation and challenges. I compliment the organizers for having chosen such topics, though it is quite a challenge to the speaker himself. Sai mission and its continuity. There are two points here, his mission and continuity. The third point is our doubt whether it will continue or not. Or else we never say and its continuity. We doubt whether it's going to be continuous or discontinuous. Why that doubt has arisen? For the simple reason that Swami is not amidst us in his physical frame. I can certainly understand the psychology, rationale, and the logic behind the topic given to me. I'm also one like you, feeling his physical absence, cry within, though smile outside, but could not control the tears at moments when I refer to touching, intimate moments with Swami, the kind of love I received from him at an individual level. That apart, let me speak on the topic because I'm the one who believes that all those things which are universally applicable, generally applicable, acceptable, need to be mentioned, but not individual dreams, individual personal experiences, general things. Sai mission, what is the first principle of Sai mission? People ask so many questions. What does he want to achieve? Has Swami achieved what he wanted to? What has he attained? What is his mission? Is he successful in his mission? These are all the questions raised by people wherever I go. I encourage questions. If you do not encourage, these questions will be raised outside. And once they go out of our own parameters, they get diverted, distorted, perverted directions and comprehensions. I don't want to give room for that. Even at home, I encourage my children to ask me whatever they like. I'm not a dictator at home or in the classroom. Most of the children find comfortable at their friend's house. Why? Because we silence them at home. Most of them wanted to have a break towards the weekend, to have a break from the elders. Therefore, I am not of the kind to silence people. Even in the classroom, I encourage them. So against this background, I really encourage you to put questions. If you have any, I know you have many. What is the mission of Sai? Does he want to make us all wealthy? Does he want to make us all healthy, wealthy? What is purpose? What is his mission? So many things have been said by so many people. Many, many books have been written. Many songs have been composed. The whole bookstore there in Prasanthalayam has thousands of books of collection for sale in all national, international languages. How am I to sum up Sai mission? My friends, Sai mission can be summed up in one line, in one sentence. All the rest of the things come under that. Something like, if you have sugar, you can have any number of sweets. Without sugar, you cannot make any sweet. So the sweetness of Sai mission, the sugar of Sai mission, the essence of Sai mission, the quintessence of Sai mission is this: experiencing the divinity within, experiencing or realizing the divinity within. That's all his divine mission. All of the things are associated with that. Realizing divinity within. Is the mic clear? Is there any problem? No? Okay. Mic is all right. Problem maybe with my throat. Okay, now. Realizing divinity within. Let me say a few points on this. Have we realized divinity within? No. Why? We want to see God outside in a temple. Very comfortable. Oh God, you be there, let me be here. You do your job, allow me to do my job. Of course, on Saturday, I'll come to you, or on Sunday, apologize to you for all the sins committed, so that from Monday, I can begin next account. Confessions are of that nature. All right, oh God, let my daughter be married without a dowry, possibly, to a person with a green card working in US. If you do that, I'll bake 6 coconuts. Is that okay? So poor God waits for our 6 coconuts so as to procure a son-in-law for you without a dowry and a green card. This is business, not religion. Tagging God, linking God with personal desire, personal obligation is business. Religion is not business. Religion is not a financial deal. Some say, oh God, I'll give my hair if you do that. In fact, God is responsible for the hair I have. Why does he want his hair back? See that? So we are happy by thinking that God is outside in a temple. We are also happy by restricting God, confining God to a day or an hour. Some people, when I go on visit, they say, Mr. Anil Kumar, would you like to see my meditation room? Out of courtesy, etiquette, decency, I go and see and come back. But I laugh within myself. If that is the meditation room, other rooms are non-meditation rooms, right? Some say, would you like to see my puja room? Then other rooms are, then what? So our puja meant a room. Our meditation meant a room. That is not religion. salvation is not confined to that, is not limited to that, to a day and a time. And some also boast. I met one housewife who said, "Mr. Anil Kumar, my father-in-law meditates every day from 4:30 to 5:30. I said, "Wonderful. How does he know it is 5:30? You wake him up, or does he stop himself, or you keep alarm there? These are all misconceptions, misapprehensions about religion in the modern society. So Swami said, realizing the divinity within. When that is within, you cannot say, "I meet you, O God, on Saturday," because you are alive from Monday to Friday. So long I am alive, so long the heart beats, so long the blood pulsates or moves, so long the thought process goes on, so long there is life, we need to know God within. We need to realize God within. Well, how am I to believe that? The anatomy does not show God in the body after dissection. No. Any surgical operation would not find any God in any cell, in any part. That God whom you don't see, how to believe that there is insight? All the food that we consume would act to the body from within. It is not like car tires where you inflate every tire with gas. No. Do you do that? There's no gas filling station for the body. We may suffer from gas problems. Why gas filling? There's enough for gas inside. And most of us, what we talk is also gas also. So it's silly. The food that goes in helps to develop the body, grow the body, strong and healthy from inside, not from outside. Blood flows inside, not outside. Whole thing takes place inside. Simple example, laddu, sweet is there. You enjoy the sweetness inside, not outside. If you enjoy the sweetness outside, you don't have to buy the sweet at all. Just to see the... inside power generation, you cannot see. You may have eyeballs, but you cannot see. Many blind people may have eyelids and eyeballs, but they can't see. Why? Something inside missing. The ears may be so beautiful or ugly, whatever may be, as big as the size of an elephant ear, but when that auditory nerve is missing, when tympan, drum, something goes wrong, you cannot hear. Being not able to hear is a blessing at times, but not always. But even Vasa shouts at you, it's good to be deaf. So audition from inside, sound outside. Vision from inside, scenery outside. Taste inside, food is outside. So everything is operated within. Just examine yourself. Sense of touch, you feel inside. Therefore you feel it. Or else whereas his body doesn't feel any sense of touch. Therefore, my friends, most of the things happen inside. How do they happen? There is a main meter, amplifier you can say, or a generator, you can say that. The main switch supplies current to the eyes to see, current to the ears to hear, current to the tongue to taste, current to the skin to touch, sense of touch. That main switch is what is called consciousness. That main switch is consciousness. That is what you call the self, or the spirit, or super consciousness, or awareness. Terms are many. Awareness, consciousness, super consciousness, the spirit, Atma. That is the main switch. And that goes. Therefore, we are able to stand, we are able to draw. So, that also happens from inside. So, if anything goes wrong within, how our beautiful outside is useless. In some shops, cloth showrooms, you have plastic dolls, you know, of my size, of your size, who are more good looking than all of us. That doesn't mean we are going to marry a doll there. Useless. They are good looking, but there is no operation inside. Therefore, fundamental point we have to be convinced is there is divinity within. And this divinity within has to be realized, has to be experienced. How do you realize the divinity? How do you experience the divinity? Within. How? See, when once I open my eyes, I see all of you. The moment I close my eyes, nothing but darkness. Meaning plurality, multiplicity, duality outside. When you close your eyes, unity, non-duality, entity, oneness is the reality. So when once you open your eyes, plurality, multiplicity. When you close your eyes, it is oneness, non-duality, uniformity. When you close your eyes, you don't see anybody. If anyone says, I see so many people, though I close my eyes, something interesting. There are places for such people. The best fitting place is a mental hospital. So we don't see that. Therefore, my friends, we should clearly understand, eyes open, multiplicity. Closed, uniformity. When I begin to listen to everything, so many sounds, Sai gatherings are different. If you go to some other gathering where some cinema artist addresses are some film stars, most of the people film stars are from Malaysia. I was wondering why people come to Malaysia. Now I understand there is a justification. Because you cannot transplant Langkawi to India. Impossible. And you cannot transplant Penang over there. It's a beautiful country. It is really beautiful. Therefore, people come here for filmmaking. Oh, when film stars come, what happens? Many people come. Suppose you, there's one film star here. I'm sure there's a very big crowd. Many more waiting outside. Some police also are required to control the mob. Yes, you got it. But religion is not filmmaking. Spirituality is not screen watching. It is something personal. It is something intimate. It is something emotional, touching, that goes into the depth. That's the reason why religious meetings are less attended. Fish market, very busy. Vegetable market, very busy. Malls, not even inch to work. But some spiritual discourse somewhere, retired people may attend. Why? Because they are tired to sit at home, so they come to the temple to hear. So we have no time to think of this because we are attracted. We are attracted by the vision, by the scenery. We are attracted by sounds. We are attracted by smell. Five senses of the body: shabda, rupa, sparsha, rasa, gandha. The sound, the taste, touch, the smell. Five senses attract us. They will not allow you to go within. So long when you keep the doors open, wind blows freely. When once you close the doors, Harivom, everything comes to a standstill. So we are drawn towards plurality or multiplicity, advaita, advaita, because of the senses drawn towards outside objects. All outside objects to our attention. So we think this is the world. We think this is reality, forgetting the fact there's something inside. And a small incident, what happened? Somebody presented Swami a beautiful car. People don't leave him unless he accepts. They cry from Monday to Saturday. Then he has to melt on Sunday. Or they put it in the garage. So that car is brought there. Swami called me, Anil Kumar, get into the car. I got in the car. We had a lovely ride. And then he was talking to me like a child. You see, the glass pans are closed, right? Of the car. Yes, Swami. Shout loudly. Oh, glasses down. You say that. Swami said, say loudly. I said, down. The glasses down. Have you seen that? Oh, Swami. Then we had more fun to that. I said, Swami, when I said down, pants are down now. Glasses. Swami say up. They go, huh? Come on, you say. Hey, up. Then Swami laughed and laughed. Ah, that is my car. And then, you know why they have ray switches here? Up, down. That's how I make you up and down in life. Every part of the car, a flower, or a kerchief, or a situation, or a person, becomes an object, becomes an incident, an excuse, an alibi for Swami to come out with his divine message. So the pants up and down because of the switch. That switch is inside. Eyes up, down, ears up, down, because of the switch inside. And that is divinity within. So long you see the glasses, you don't see the switch. When you look at the switch, you are not thrilled, excited by the glass pans coming up and down. Natural, you are operated. Similarly, those with outer vision, bahirdrishti, or external experience, phenomenal world, momentary world, fleeting pleasures, cannot experience the divinity within. Those that have experience within can easily manage what all is happening outside. Something like this. A driver who knows how to apply brake, when to apply accelerator, easy for him to drive. Creation, if observed properly, will take us go within. to know the Creator. Then once the Creator is known, creation is already known. Because the secret is understood. The essence is known. Therefore, realizing the divinity within many, to know that consciousness operating from within. That's what Baba says. Once you know, then Hyderabad, you must have heard about it, capital of Andhra Pradesh, we were all dining. Swami said, Anil Kumar, what are you eating? Swami, sambar, sweets, hearts, curries, that's all. Why do you eat? Why people eat? Swami, so that we have strength. Right. In this glass, place there 2 spoons of sambar. 2 spoons of sambar. 2 spoons of rasam. Some idli. With the glass growing size, same stuff you are eating. Same stuff here in the glass. But you are adding meat. This does not. Why? That is God. That is God. Same stuff in the body leads to growth. Same stuff outside does not lead to growth. So experiencing the divinity within, to know that it is a primal cause for human life. Life sojourn on earth, that's clearly understood. This is the first mission of Sai. All others are associated with that. If we ask Dr. Ravindran, if you ask Brother Mahendran, they'll tell you a list of service activities we have undertaken. When there is tsunami, such as the organization is the first to go there. When there is fire havoc, we are first to show our appearance. Very good. But Baba's question is, should you wait for again another tsunami? Should you wait for some fire accident to take place? No. All the service activities carry with them the spirit of service. The spirit of service is more important than service activities. Are they different? Yes. People serve, but they don't have spirit of service. How do you say that? Swami gives one example. It is Tokyo in Japan. Winter season. And one lady was passing by the street. She saw many people shivering because of the cold season. She purchased few blankets and started distributing them. Every street she used to visit a day and distribute blankets. This has gone to the notice of the government. Government won't keep quiet. Immediately they said, "For a great lady, let us honor you." Honor me? Yes. Why? You are serving poor people. You are clothing them. You are giving them blankets. Then this lady started crying. Why do you cry? Then that lady says, "Look here. When God has given so many things to every one of us, the very birth of a human being, the very life to understand, to experience, enjoy. When there are millions of people suffering in this world, after all, I must have given blankets to a couple of hundreds of people, and you want to honor me? No. When God has done so much, if I am to be honored for this, It is a dishonor to me. I decline. That is the spirit of service. Spirit of service. My friends, I'm so happy that you are listening to me in rapt attention. It is not the quantity that matters. It is the quality that counts. Spirit of service does not crave for publicity. Does not go for propaganda. Does not expect any recognition. Does not expect any reward or award in return. Spirit of service is non-expectational. Spirit of service is selfless. Whereas in service, you all sit there, I read a report. 1,000 people, we distributed food. 1,000 people, I distributed clothes. Keep quiet. 1,000 you have distributed. About 10,000 outside. So service is propaganda. Spirit of service is simplicity. In service, you think, I am serving you. All of you sit down. Take this, take this. That is service. Spirit of service is, I am not serving you, brother. I am serving myself. By making you happy, I am happy. By giving you warm clothing, I am happy. When you suffer, I suffer. When you cry, I also cry. So I'm not serving anybody, I'm serving myself. So spirit of service is service to one's own self. Whereas mere service is service to somebody else. Service also thinks of some deservedness. People say that all people, poor people, be here at 11 o'clock, we'll give you food. Those fellows will feel so bad because you call them poor. To be called poor is much worse than being poor. In service, one who serves considers himself greater. I am king. Oh. But the spirit of service, no superiority complex. No inferiority complex. It is only an offering to one's own self. Baba gives an example. But all I am telling is from Sai literature only. I repeat this at every meeting because these days many interpreters have come into existence. I don't have to. Baba said this beautiful example. You look into my eye. Look straight into my eyeball. What do you find? Your reflection, right? I look into you. I see my reflection. Then who are you? Me. Who am I? You. Who are we? Only one. This is the spirit of service. To seeing yourself in the other person as divine is called spirit of service. Sai mission is service with a spirit of service. Service is seva, a karma or action. Karma is action. With the spirit added to that, it becomes karma yoga. Karma yoga. Yoga means a connecting link. When you have the spirit of service, it links you with God. Yoga, union. So union with God is possible where there is spirit of service. Sai Mission First Service SAI. Yes, service. Karma Yoga. The service with the spirit of service. Two. Letter A. We often think offering flowers is bhakti, a collection of flowers. There are some fools who pluck out flowers from the temple garden, offer them to God there. Ayyayo, the garden belongs to him. You pluck flowers from the temple garden and offer them to God. What ridiculous thing it is. Even if you buy outside and offer it, those flowers will think, it's not yours. It belongs to the rose plant. And you just take it away for 10 paisa. Ta-da, good God, and he'll be very happy. See that. This is what is called mechanical worship. Routine worship. Computerized worship. Programmed worship. Lifeless worship. Why? Get flowers, throw it at his feet. Good. Certainly not. Offering flowers is not worship. When you offer flowers, oh God, this flower of thought, this flower of my mind, this flower of the vibration, this flower of a feeling, this flower of a sentiment are offered to you, Swami. With that feeling, if you offer, that is what we call spirit of worship. Attendance should be more in some temples. So much puliyavara, so much of payasam and mango fruits. Full gathering. Why? Prasad. The prasad in summer in India, people offer mango fruits also. Additional attraction. Big size. Prasadam, puliyavara, payasam in a bag. So that you don't have to cook that night. Very good. Worship. But there's no spirit there. What is the spirit? Swami, prasadam I offer now is an offering of the results of my action. Karma phala. Karma phala is the consequence of the results of one's own action. Swami, whatever I have done, whatever name I got, whatever money I got, whatever dignity, the status I enjoy, I submit unto you, Swami. They belong to you. That is spirit of worship. Some people bring waters from all rivers all over the country. This is Narmada River, Yamuna River, Saraswati River, whatever may be, water H2O, that's all. Yamuna is not H3O. Saraswati is not H4O. H2O. Unless you say, I cannot know which one is Saraswati, which one is Yamuna. So they attach a label. Yamuna, 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 Saraswati, Saraswati. And they say, there is Abhisheka with waters from all rivers. Morning 9 o'clock till 12 o'clock in the afternoon, followed by prasadam distribution. Crowds, huge crowds, because they want to see different types of waters. I don't understand. That is only mechanical. I'm not undermining, my friends. I'm not criticizing. I'm not attacking. I'm not against these rituals. I'm trying to bring to your attention that ritual
should lead you to spiritual. If the ritual does not lead to spiritual, it is just a ritual. Come on, roll some flour, go away. That's it. So our worship, be that with flowers, or abhishek are the waters, or breaking of the coconut, whatever may be, or offering fruits, that is all external ritual. To know that the water over there, abhisheka, is nothing but the incessant flow of tears in gratitude to Swami. Oh God, you saved my life. Oh God, you settled my family. Oh God, you have given me health. Oh God, you have given me wealth. Out of gratitude, if you have got the tears rolling, that is true abhisheka, not big containers of water. All the sea water is full there. Come on. Return, Sivalinga. Neither you nor the sea are going to be blessed. Tears of joy, tears of happiness, tears of gratitude, tears of repentance, tears of regrets, the tears of thanksgiving to God is proper abhisheka. Simple example. On the Independence Day, we have this example. Swami said, we hoist the national flag. National flag of Prague, only a piece of cloth. Why should you salute? Piece of cloth. This piece of cloth represents the nation. So you salute. Similarly, worship represents offering of the feelings, sentiments, thoughts, offering fruits of merit, sacrificing the result of your actions. This is spirit of worship. And there's also another one. We say, Baba is very kind. Good. How about you? How about you? Rama speaks truth. Are you? Drama. You drama speaks untruth. Krishna stands for peace. And you? Pieces. No peace, only pieces. What do you mean by this? Ashtotara, 108 names. Sahasranama, 1000 names. Lalita Sahasranama, Vishnu Sahasranama, Ashtotara. All of them speak the divinity of God, the divine nature of God, the divine attributes, the divine traits, the divine qualities. Oh God, you are Kalayanama, you are the time. Kalatitayanama, you transcend time. Yes. So I praise God. There are some people who say, oh God, you are very kind. You are very compassionate. Are you giving him titles or any felicitation function? No. Praising God is not a certificate that you give to him. He has not become kind because of you. He has been kind, and the very kindness itself, kindness embodied, is God. Love personified is God. So when you appreciate God, the underlying meaning is cultivate those qualities. Swami, you are love. Let me be loving. Swami, you are truth. Let me speak truth. So when we worship Ashtotara, Sahasranamavali, this is what is called stuti, meaning praise of God. Stotra, we go on praising God. Stuti or stotra represents a quality, a guna. Guna is the quality. Stotra is appreciation. If this appreciation, encomiums, or tributes, or praise, there lies behind guna archana, guna archana. Cultivating those qualities for myself. Oh God, you're compassionate. Let me be compassionate. Oh God, you love everybody. Let me also love God. That is true worship. Some people say, I do Sahasranama 1,000 times. Do it 1,00,000 times, you will be like that. DVD does it. That doesn't mean DVD is going to attain moksha. DVD, CD, Sahasranamas, all of them are there. I'm sorry. Life is not an electronic gadget. Life has an application, interaction. You cut a joke, the others laugh. When you explain a sentiment, the others also share that. This is communication. This is interlink. When you praise God, I'm supposed to cultivate at least one. Sahasranama 108, cultivate one. Sahasra 1,000. Out of so many attributes that you praise, if you cannot cultivate one, it is only waste of time, leading to pain in the throat, disturbance to the neighbor. You know, I'm not telling about anybody. In the early days coming to Swami fold, I was very much after Sai bhajans. I like. In this world, if there are any bhajans that are so simple, that are so captivating, that are so enchanting, that are electrifying, that are energizing, that are unifying, that are uniform, are Sai bhajans only. Sai bhajans only. Nowhere. You go to Mexico, they speak Spanish language. They don't follow what we say. When you start singing a song, they start singing a song. Why? That bhajan is known to them. Bhajan is the only communication between us. I've been to Mexico. They don't know my language, nor do I know their language. They were smiling and I was smiling. To a third person, both of us may look mad. But to me, all those that laugh at us are doubly mad. Why? We enjoy Sai bhajans. We share the melody of Sai bhajans. The thrill of Sai bhajans. That unifying fact. So my friends, worship should be meaningful, fruitful, with the true spirit, guna archana, get his qualities. What are those gunas? Ahimsa pradhamam pushpam. The first flower to be offered is non-violence. Pushpam indriya nigraham. Self-control is the second flower. Ahimsa pradhamam pushpam. Pushpam indriya nigraham. Sarvabhuta daya pushpam. Compassion. Kshama pushpam. Abundance. Shanti pushpam, peace. Dhyana pushpam, meditation. Tapa pushpam, penance. Satya pushpam, truth. Nine forms of asadala. These are the qualities we are supposed to cultivate. It is for that reason we worship. Therefore, bhakti ritual. When that bhakti followed in full awareness of the depth of the implications behind worship becomes bhakti yoga. So bhakti yoga calls for response, sensitivity. If you look at Paramahamsa, Swami said, if you lie down on bed, if you hear somebody saying Rama, he'll get up immediately. Krishna, he'll get up immediately. Whereas most of us, when bhajan goes on, we can nicely sleep. Snoring also added to that. Special features. Meaning, bhajan is mechanical. Some are bothered to know who is singing, who is playing the drums. It is not a cultural program. Bhajan is not a cultural program. Baba gives one example. It seems a king is so proud of Tan Sen in his court. Tan Sen, the best musician of those days. The king is very proud of him. He declared to the whole world, the best possible musician is in my court. One day, Akbar went along the riverside, Yamuna. He saw a beggar singing in praise of God. That voice is more melodious. There's rhythm there. There's vibration there. Then he came, even so sorry. Summoned Tan Sen. Oh, Tan Sen, I thought you were the best singer. But I met a beggar there on the street who is singing much, much better than. Then Tan Sen said with folded hands, Oh Lord, that beggar on the street was singing in praise of God, looking at the face of God. So it is stopped. I am singing looking at your face. Therefore, I am looking at your face, therefore this is the standard. I am not responsible. Therefore, my friends, it is not the melody or the music or the musician that matters. When you sing, you forget time. When you sing, you forget space. When you sing, you are lost. Singer is gone, and song remains. Dancer is gone, dance remains. Painter is out of context. Painting remains. You must have heard of Picasso. Picasso, the greatest painter. One day, there was an exhibition of paintings. Picasso also went to see his own paintings. He was looking at it. Somebody said, Picasso, that's your painting, you know. $1 lakh. Have I drawn? I see. What does it mean? Picasso allowed himself to be a painter in the hands of God. Therefore, marvelous painting. You think that I am a painter that live in the street, not in a museum. Therefore, bhakti yoga, meaning forgetfulness of your own entity. Forgetfulness of your ownership. Forgetfulness of enjoyership. Kartrutva bhava, doership. Bhoktrutva bhava, enjoyership. I am doing, that should go. This credit should come to me, that should go. Enjoyership, doership, when they are gone, that bhakti becomes bhakti yoga. Such bhakti only will connect me to God. This is the mission of Sai. Somebody asked me, why do you sing on the road? Why do you sing on the road? I said, how are you bothered? And some say, others will think you are mad. Why do you sing? Let others think, man. I think they are mad. So why do you bother about it? Therefore, bhakti yoga should connect you to God. And if it remains you there, it is bhakti, but not bhakti yoga. Sai mission, adoration. Yes, service, karma yoga. Adoration, bhakti yoga. Then comes third eye, illumination. What is illumination? Jnana. Jnana. What is jnana? If I say he has so much of jnana, but he is ajnani, ignorant. You may read any number of books, still ajnani. You may get any number of degrees, still ajnani. What is jnana? What is true jnana? Advaita darshanam jnanam. Advaita darshanam jnana. The experience of non-duality, to feel that oneness, is true jnana. You are a Malaysian, I'm Indian, you Johor Bahru, they belong to Penang. Groupism is not jnana. Division is not jnana. Unity is jnana. Division is a jnana. All the rest is only collection of books. Today, things are so simple. We don't have to read books. Go to Google. You'll get any information. Students stop going to library. Students stop reading a book. Google. That's not jnana. That is only vidya, education. Vidya is different from jnana. Vidya, education, is information. Whereas jnana is wisdom, which is transformation. So jnana, the wisdom, is transformation. Vidya, the knowledge, is information. A knowledgeable man, jnana, is so simple, so humble, so simple. Take Tukaram, or Kabir, any strong word. Or in our days, Teresa. Mother Teresa, how simple she is. She comes with that. Whereas we fellow, it's a matter of shame. I may have any number of PhDs, but it's a shame. Simplicity, that submissiveness, that respectfulness, that lovingness, that reverence are the qualities of wisdom. When Teresa was awarded Nobel Prize, she didn't say it is too late. She didn't say she should have given me 10 years ago. She said, it is a recognition for the need of service to the needy people. Recognition of service to the poor and needy people. That's what Nobel Prize is. That's what she said. Think of Swami Ranganathananda, our Ramakrishna mission, head there. Then government said, we'll give you Padma Bhushan or something like that. He said, I am sorry. You cannot award me like that. I represent Ramakrishna mission. I represent an organization. I am not an individual. Suppose if I am of that level, Ranganathananda, I said, please let me know when I should come. Let me know where I should be seated. Because I am a knowledgeable man. There is a man of wisdom. Man of wisdom. Take for example, sun. Sun shines brilliantly. Without sun, we cannot live. He doesn't expect any thanks from you. Surya Namaskar, or you may not do it. So, great noble things. Oneness, I tell you, that life in an ant, life in a caterpillar,
pillar,
that life in a grass blade, smile on the face of a baby, the sound in the flow of a river, the sound as waves upsurge, dash against the shore, the breeze that touches the flowers, the cool breeze that touches your skin is divine. That is divine. This is what's called jnana or wisdom. To feel divinity everywhere. I could come here because of Baba. Or who wants me in Jehovah? I'm not a matter. Why? It's God's design. It's the divine plan. So I'm here. To feel God's presence. Every situation is through jnana that links you with God. Jnana yoga. Sai service, karma yoga, A adoration, bhakti yoga, I illumination, jnana yoga. That's it. And its continuity. That is the second part. I know that you are very sharp enough. I also see youngsters here. If I don't speak on the second part, they will say, Anil Kumar nicely avoided. I don't avoid. I don't avoid, and you cannot avoid me. Continuity. Because we think there may be discontinuity. Let us observe where there is continuity, where there is discontinuity. Let us observe. Here is a wheel. The wheel goes on rotating, changing, up, down, down, up. But the central pivot, unchanging. When earth turns towards the sun, daytime. When it turns against the sun, it is night. But sun is a sun. He doesn't change. For the change of the day and night, that sun, changeless sun, is the main cause. So one unchanging is the cause for that which is changing. Am I clear, please? Both cannot change. Simple. There's a railway track, iron bars. The train is going. If the bars also start going, we will not be going to the destination. We will be going to the other planet safely. So the railway track is unchanging. The train is changing. Day and night are changing. Sun is not changing. Similarly, changeless is the cause for the change. That which does not change is continuous. That which changes is discontinuous. I think I'm clear. Nature is changing, discontinuous. Creation is changing, discontinuous. But Creator is continuous. Creator is continuous. He doesn't change. Another example. These are all, Swami said. First, child. Child becomes grows to a boy. Boy develops into youth. Later, father. Later, grandfather. Positions are changing. Child, boy, man, father, grandfather. They're changing. But he is unchanging. I cannot say Anil Kumar the child, Anil Kumar the father, Anil Kumar the grandfather. Then you regret for having been here. You start inquiring who invited me. Therefore, my friends, I self is continuous. Whereas different phases, matras, pachas to come there. శీతోష్ణసు దుఃఖమ ఆగమాయను నిత్యం స్థాం స్థితి క్షస్వ భారత. ద సీజన్స్ గో ఆన్ చేంజింగ్, సన్ ఇస్ స్టడీ. మై లైఫ్ హెస్ బీన్ చేంజింగ్ బట్ ఐ ఆమ్ ద సేమ్. సో దాట్ విచ్ ఇస్ చేంజ్లెస్ ఇస్ కంటిన్యూస్, దాట్ విచ్ ఇస్ చేంజింగ్ ఇస్ డిస్కంటిన్యూస్. ఆమ్ ఐ క్లియర్? నౌ సాయి'స్ మిషన్ అండ్ ఇట్స్ కంటిన్యూటీ. వెన్ సాయి ఇస్ ద క్రియేటర్, ఇట్ హ్యాస్ టు బి కంటిన్యూస్. వెన్ సాయి ఇస్ గాడ్, దెన్ బి కంటిన్యూటీ. ఇఫ్ యు థింక్ గాడ్ ఈజ్ మ్యాన్, ద క్వశ్చన్ కంటిన్యూటీ అరైజెస్. దిస్ ఇస్ ది స్పిరిచువల్ ఇంటర్ప్రిటేషన్ ఫ్రమ్ ది ఫిజికల్ లెవెల్. సింపుల్ ఎగ్జాంపుల్, the seniors are seated in front of me, you can check with them, you can check with them. One person goes to Swami and tells him, I will donate 100 crores for the hospital. Who asked him to donate? Nobody. Did Swami ask for it? Nobody. Is there his name written there? No. Newspaper publication? No. TV telecast? No. Who asked him to give? Antaranga Sai. Anathanatha Sai. Sai the Inveller. He motivates you. Who brought you here? It's a rainy day. That too, a working day. You can relax. Spend time with your children and families. Enjoy TV. Why are you here? I don't think that you have come here because of my charm here. I'm not charismatic. I'm not Aishwarya Roy. No, I'm Hrithik Roshan. Yeah. Then what brought you here? Not charisma. No. No charm. No Filmfare Awards. Why have you come? He made you come. That is my faith and conviction. He made you to come here. Therefore you are here. Similarly, my friends, Sai mission will continue because he will motivate within. He will inspire within. He will speak to you. Go to bhajans, go to bhajans. In those days, early days of having been exposed to Swami, we used to attend bhajan every day with children. Even on a rainy day, grandmother, grandfather, everybody, as members of opposition, strong opposition. You can go tomorrow, why did you go today? If the children catch cold, what will happen? If they get fever, what will happen? Appa, appa, appa. As they go on putting questions like that. In the meantime, there's a rickshaw there. Hari Om, we go in our own way. Why do you go like that? There's a call within. Baba, come, attend bhajans. Come on, come on, come on. You cannot stop it. Sir, why is it not happening to me? Why is it happening to you? Because you are a devotee, it is happening. I'm not a devotee. This is my question. When you are a lover, when you love somebody, go there, go there. Who asked you to go there? Why? Wait at the college gate, she will be coming. Wait at the gates of the theater, she will be coming. Who asked you to go? Who asked you to wait? That's your love for her. If this ordinary, physical, worldly lover engages your attention, how about God? His love is continuous. His love is infinite. His love is unconditional, selfless. How much more it will attract you? Yes, it will. That love brought you here. and I thank you. I'm thanking God in you. Thanking Baba in you, who brought you here this pleasant evening in spite of hurdles. Therefore, my friends, continuity has no doubt about it, because Sai is the divine motivator. Continuity is no doubt because Sai is the inveller. Sai inspires. He guides you. Okay, then why should you come here? Many guys, many plans, why should I be here? That may be your question. When Swami guides you, why should you be here? The answer is this. Swami says, one example. When the cameraman is there to click your picture, what should you do? Turn towards the lens. And it's a smile piece. Give him smile. How nicely can you can have too? Smile. Suppose you had turned on my back. Can you take my picture? Impossible. Because that's camera lens, it is not X-ray. You cannot take my picture if I turn back. Similarly, Sai mission is continuous. You turn positive towards it. With the spirit of acceptance towards it. With the spirit of dedication to that. With the spirit of surrender to that. With absolute selflessness. My boys, I'm happy to be here for the second reason. There are many youngsters here. I see many youngsters. This is more necessary for youngsters. Because which of us, we completed our innings long back. We may get down the station any moment. You have got a long journey to go. So you should be inspired. You should have experience. Simple example. Participate in a service activity. Tell me your experience. Nobody will ever say boring, impossible. In service activity, when poor lady smiles, when a poor man thanks you, it is worth the whole world. If a hungry person is fed, it is worth the whole universe. What is the difference between God and creation? Ah, must be a man of jnana. Wisdom. Oh, I'll give Baba's example. You stand in front of the mirror. What do you find in the mirror? Your own reflection, right? Take away the mirror. Do you find reflection?
No.
So, creation is the mirror. God is the object. Reflection yourself. You are the jiva, the individual soul. God is deva, the universal soul. Deva, jiva are different. Deva, universal soul, God looks into the mirror of the world, prapancha, comprising five elements, panchabhuta, and he finds individual soul. Remove the nature. Only God remains. That's what Holy Bible says. God made man in his own image. That's what Christ declared. I and my Father in heaven are one. That's what Prophet Muhammad said. I am the light. The light is in me. I am the light. And I am the light, says Prophet Muhammad. So this duality is because of the mirror, the creation, the nature. When the mirror is there, not there, non-duality, God himself. Why did Swami left so many gold bars in the cupboards in his room? staying there in Prashantan Lane, being close to him, I have no access to cupboards. I have not seen gold bars. From Johor Bahru you could see cupboards and I don't know what to say. Is Dura Drishti, distance vision, or Dura Drishti, unfortunate bad vision? Yes. It may be Dura Drishti, bad luck. I think Dura Drishti, distance look. It is Dura Drishta, but unfortunate. I have not seen cupboards. I have not seen gold bars. There are no bars to Prashantalaya. Therefore, it's only imagination, the newspapers, TV channels, what's a sensation? Simple example. You have been watching me sipping water. If a journalist is there, Sai Baba devotee Anil Kumar drinks. Drinks what? Drinking water. And alcohol. He likes he drinks. Is it wrong? Correct. Drinks. What? Sensation. So that's the sensation. News is nuisance. Some people are saying they are Baba in trance. They advise many what things, what is perception and trance. Trance, what is trance? I don't believe what trance is. Liquor acts quicker. Yes. A bottle will take you to trance. Alcohol, C2H5OH. It is not spiritual, it is spirit alcohol. So, what is trance? Trance meaning mind being totally gone, mad. A drunkard goes on shouting. Somebody fellow falls on my feet on the roof. He is in trance. He doesn't know on whose feet he should fall. Why? So trance meaning alcoholic intoxication. But spirituality is not trance. Transcendence. Transcend. Transcendence. What is transcend? Sir, Muthu sir, you are a great man. Sir, I am so sorry, I never expected from you. He is not affected by my praise or blame. That is transcendence. Sir, is it true that you lost so much money? Oh, I see. Sir, you got so much of profit? So much for gas, do you know that? So transcendence meaning not affected by dualities, polarity of opposites, the contradictions. So transcend, attaining the state of transcendence. Trance is physical, transcendence is spiritual. Trance is dangerous. We go on taking alcohol every day. We have that trance, you will end up in hospital. Transcendence, you are a yogi, you are calm and peaceful. Trance, people will hate you. Society will neglect you. Transcend transcendence, people worship you. People will be your followers. That is the difference between trance and transcendence. I have seen a number of devotees get dreams and push that in the Sai centers. What is your view on the dreams? My view on the dreams is this. Dreams are totally personal. They are not general. They are not universal. How do I say that? Christian dreams of Christ only, not Krishna. Right? Krishna followers dream of Krishna only, not Prophet Muhammad. Why? Personal. You are in the field, you are along the path, you dream the path and the goal. But dreams cannot be generalized. Sometimes dreams are contradictory. Sometimes dreams are controversial. Sometimes dreams are said out of ego. Ego. Then, how about Baba dreams? Baba appearing in the dreams? Do they also speak of ego? Do they also stand for superiority, complex? Friends, be very clear. Baba appearing in the dream is not a dream. Oh, then what? It is a vision. Vision of Baba. You can say dream of Baba. Vision, nobody will question. Dreams, people keep a distance from you. A dream is ambiguous. I dreamt I was walking along the Juhu beach. Confusion in a dream. Vision is very clear. Go to Sai Center. Go to service activity. Very clear. No confusion. In a dream, unfulfilled desires are expressed there. Incomplete tasks appear there. In a dream, I can be President of America. Why not? White House. It's a fallacy. It's a fiction. So dreams may be fictitious, fallacious, but vision is straight. Dreams are psychological. Visions are spiritual. Dreams are mind-prompted. Visions are intellectual awakening. Intellectual awakening. Intuitive awakening. Totally divine. So let's not dream. Let's have visions. Spiritually speaking, whole life is a dream. This is a daydream. That is a night dream. When there is night dream, then there is no daydream. When there is daydream, there is no night dream. But dreamer is there in both the times. Dreamer is the reality. Daydream is the waking state. Night dream is dreaming state or swapna. No dream state is sushupti. That's another topic. There's something wrong with teachers, you know. When they get in the college, that's another topic altogether. So think of the dreamer, not of the dreams. That's all for the day. Thank you very much.
On behalf of the organizing committee, I'd like to thank Professor Anil Kumar for the enlightening talk on Sai mission and its continuity. We also would like to thank Brother Mahendran, our Deputy President of Sathya Sai Council of Malaysia, for accompanying Professor all through the journey, the holy mission that he has undertaken. Last but not least, the organizing committee should also be given a round of applause. They have put together in ensuring the success of this event. Jai Jai Shaira. Thank you very much.
Please come, sir. Come closer.
Thank you. How time is just...
So nice to have you on. photo, you see. Why don't you both come and join us? Come on, let's have a photograph with you. Why not?
Before we end, we have to do aarti, and with that we'd like to call Professor and Sister Vijaya to come forward and take aarti. Sister Vijaya, please come forward.
And you too.
Thank you. I don't know.